Hello, this is Vince Bojan in the Penn State Materials Characterization Laboratory, and I'm going to give you an introduction to the basic principles and applications of Auger Electron Spectroscopy. The Auger process is associated with the de-excitation of an atom that has been initially excited by the creation of a vacancy in a core shell of the atom. Let's refer to this energy level diagram for the titanium atom on the left. The initial core shell vacancy in these energy level diagrams is indicated by the pink arrows. When an atom is excited this way, it will spontaneously relax by having an electron drop from a higher shell into the core hole. When the electron does that, the energy associated with that transition can be released from the atom in one of two principal ways. In one case, when the electron drops into the core vacancy, an X-ray photon will be emitted, and that process is referred to as X-ray fluorescence. In the other case, when the outer shell electron drops in the core vacancy, the atom releases an electron from another shell in the atom, and that electron is called an Auger electron. So when we do Auger electron spectroscopy, we are studying the Auger electrons that are being emitted from the sample surface. When we study these characteristic X-rays, we may be using other common characterization techniques often referred to as EDS, EPMA for the electron microprobe, or XRF for X-ray fluorescence. A typical Auger instrument has a UHV system that houses all the components. During the measurement, the sample has to sit in ultra-high vacuum. And the primary excitation source in a dedicated Auger instrument is usually an electron beam that has an energy anywhere from 2 to 20 keV. And in an Auger instrument, the main electron gun allows you to generate this beam, focus it to a very small point on the surface, and raster it across the surface if desired. When that electron beam interacts with the sample surface, lots of different kinds of electrons will be emitted. You'll get secondary and backscattered electrons. You'll get inelastically scattered electrons, Auger electrons, and diffracted electrons, all coming off the sample surface. Some fraction of all of them are drawn into a kinetic energy analyzer that, in one way or another, measures the kinetic energy distribution of all this stuff coming off the surface. The output from the analyzer is fed into an electron detector, and the detector output is fed into data acquisition and processing hardware and software, which generates the typical Auger data that we analyze, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. If we want to study subsurface atoms, we need a way of etching material away, so most Auger systems also include an extra ion gun for etching the sample surface and allowing to study things subsurface. Typical kinds of data that we get fall into four categories. We can acquire straight spectra, where the kinetic energy of the electron is plotted on the x-axis and the intensity is plotted on the y-axis. The spectrum can be acquired with the excitation beam in a stationary mode, or you can acquire spectra while the beam is being rastered across an area. We can generate line scans just the same way we can in an SEM, where we move the electron beam across the sample in a linear fashion, and we look at the intensity of the Auger electrons as a function of position along this line. We can depth profile, as I mentioned earlier. We can etch surface material away and analyze the remaining surface after an etch cycle, and we can burrow down into a sample and study its composition as a function of depth that way. We can take that focused electron beam and raster it across the surface the same as we do in an SEM. And we can collect the Auger electrons that come off the surface under those conditions, and we can use those Auger electrons to generate two-dimensional images of the surface. This is the Penn State Auger instrument. You have an ultra-high vacuum chamber where all the action occurs and associated electronics and computers to drive the system. Strengths of Auger is that it can detect, like XPS, all elements in the periodic table except hydrogen and helium. It's a surface-sensitive technique with a sampling depth of typically 10 to 100 angstroms, about the same as XPS. We can do semi-quantitative work without the use of standards and surface compositions. We get excellent lateral resolution, and this is the strength of the technique. We can get lateral resolutions in the best instruments of tens to hundreds of angstroms. The Penn State instrument, we can do about 50 to 100 nanometer lateral resolution. We can sometimes see differences in the chemical environment of elements in our sample. These are some of the elements for which chemical state information can be obtained. It's not as extensive as it is for XPS, but we can do some chemical state work. We can do very rapid depth profiling, which is convenient. And when it comes to mapping, we can do elemental and sometimes chemical state mapping of sample surfaces. And of course, we get scanning electron images from secondary electrons off the surface, same way we do in an SEM. Some of the weaknesses of the technique, though, occur when we try to analyze insulators. Bulk insulators can be very difficult or impossible to analyze depending on the instrument. And this is the reason why Auger has not become as ubiquitous as XPS, is because insulator analysis can be considerably more difficult. Quantification in Auger is not quite as straightforward as it is for XPS because the matrix effects are greater. We get limited chemical state information from Auger as opposed to XPS. The detection limits are about the same, 0.1 to 1 atomic percent, depending on the element. In Auger, we have to worry about sample damage because of the focused electron beam that we use to probe the surface. Our samples have to be UHV compatible. The surface sensitivity is a blessing and a curse. There are always sample size restrictions, and there are sputtering effects associated with the depth profiling that we do, same as there are in XPS. If you look in the literature, you'll see a lot of applications of Auger. This technique has been around for a long time, so I won't read through this list, but you can scan it and see that Auger has been applied to a lot of areas of science and technology very successfully. What do typical spectra look like? If we bombard a titania thin film with a 2 keV electron beam and collect the raw data from the detector, we get the trace in black here. If we go out to the beam energy at 2 keV, we have kinetic energy, the electrons, they're being emitted on the x-axis and their intensity on the y-axis. We find a big elastic peak like we would expect at the beam energy, and then a very large inelastic tail. At this magnification, you can't see features on this inelastic tail, but if we take this portion of the spectrum and magnify it by a factor of 20, you can see these small Auger peaks riding on the much larger background. These are the peaks that we're interested in, and we have to find a way to increase the peak to background ratio here and make our very small peaks easier to see. The easiest way to remove the background is to take the first derivative of that spectrum. And if we take the first derivative of this particular distribution here, we get the spectrum in blue, where our elemental peaks jump out at us with a lot more definition. The peak to background ratio in this derivative spectrum is much higher than it is in the raw spectrum here. And you notice that the derivative has very nicely removed this large, slowly varying background. I mentioned before that Auger spectra are characteristic spectra. Every element has its own characteristic set of Auger peaks, and that's how we use the technique for elemental analysis. If you look at a bunch of spectra associated with these elements here, you can see that they're all different. They all have very systematic changes in them that relate to the electronic structure of these elements. The same is the case for the derivative spectra. Some applications. This is a defect on a silicon wafer. The scale bar here is about 10 microns. And we're interested in information about the composition of this particular defect, which is about 10 microns across. If we collect Auger spectra on this feature, that looks sort of like a flower petal and compare the spectra that we get on the feature and off the feature, we find that the spectra associated with these petals here, shown in green, have fluorine present and considerably higher amounts of carbon present than that's seen in the spectra taken off the feature. So when you compare these two, the big differences are in fluorine and carbon. That right away tells you that those elements are associated with this defect. And if we map the fluorine, for example, we find that there's a direct correlation between the presence of fluorine and in this particular defect. And so the spectra are telling us that this portion of the defect here is associated with compounds that contain fluorine and carbon. If we were to try to attempt this analysis with EDS, we would get EDS spectra similar to the ones on the right here. All we can see in these spectra are peaks for silicon and carbon. We don't see any fluorine peaks because this feature is too thin. This is a surface defect, and the information depth for EDS is much, much deeper. So we don't get any information about the fluorine in the EDS spectra. If we wanted a rough idea of how thick this defect is, we could take this whole area and very lightly etch it with an argon ion beam and collect spectra inside and outside the defect during the profile. And that is exactly what is done here. If we look at the carbon, silicon, and oxygen concentration as a function of sputtering time or depth, we find that the carbon signal associated with the defect falls off relatively rapidly. And as we etch away the native oxide here on the silicon signal comes up like we would expect. But the etch rate applied to the surface is relatively low. And because this carbon signal disappears so quickly, we can estimate that the thickness of this particular defect here is really only on the order of 10 to 15 angstroms of some kind of fluorinated carbon material. Here is a smaller structure that we are imaging in a state-of-the-art Auger. This is a carbon nanocone. This scale bar here is a tenth of a micron. So this is a very small feature. We are interested in the surface composition of this nanocone. Most of the nanocone is composed of carbon, but there are other elements of great interest here. If we gather individual spectra at locations 1 through 4, as shown here, and compare them, we find that these spectra differ considerably, especially when it comes to the distribution of elements like iron and nitrogen. We can use the Auger to go in and map those elements to get better definition of their distributions on this feature. And if we do that and we look here where iron is plotted in green and nitrogen is plotted in red, we can see that indeed there are very different distributions of those two elements on that nanocone surface, and that gives us very important information about the growth process for this particular nanocone. The area between these two distributions, of course, is just filled with carbon, although we don't have it mapped here. But the important thing to note here is the spatial resolution, the scale bar is a tenth of a micron. We couldn't do this on the Penn State instrument. Our spatial resolution would probably be about a factor of 10 worse than what you see over here. We can depth profile with our instrument. This is an example of a depth profile of a multi-layer film on silicon. There's a layer of SiO2, titanium metal, aluminum metal, and then titanium nitride. We sputter down through the film and we study the composition as a function of depth. And so we get elemental intensity on the y-axis versus depth on the x-axis. This particular depth profile was acquired under two different conditions. In the second case here, the sample was rotated while the etching was occurring to remove some of the roughness that's caused by the sputtering during the depth profile. And you can see that the depth resolution differs considerably in these two profiles. The rotation allows much, much better definition of the interfaces in the sample. So to summarize, the main differences between XPS and Auger are listed here. I'm not going to go through them. You can read them at your leisure. There are many similarities between the two techniques. There are many differences between the two techniques. So after you go through this list, if you have any questions at all about the technique or how it's used, what costs will be, anything, feel free to contact me and I would be happy to discuss the applicability of Auger to whatever materials characterization problem you might have. Thank you.